us or likely some other people are still coming in. As you might know by now, we're all from Brazil, and we're going to be presenting some perspectives about our countries, especially in terms of challenges, some legal perspectives and opportunities. We're going to be following a little bit the same strategy that Dan and Gunnan used last night, starting with some bad news and hopefully ending with better news. But since we're taking you to Brazil, and since one important aspect of Brazil that we learned yesterday is the fact that we like touching people, I would like to ask you all to stand up, look around yourselves.
Stand up, please.
And at least give your neighbors a handshake or a hug if you feel like.
Yeah.
And and I hope that
people love it.
While you're doing it, you can feel some of this positive vibe that we have been nurturing for the past few days. Oh, no. That's another way of expressing ourselves. But I prefer here we're talking about positive vibe, avoiding the no. Unless you ask me a very boring question at the end, I may answer no. Otherwise, I'll keep yes.
To dance.
Well, that's good. Now we all have smiles on our faces, and I think that's how we wanted to get this started. Thank you for being here. Thank you, Professor Whiteley, for organizing all this and for allowing me to invite those wonderful people to join me here today. I think I have done a great job choosing them, and I think you're going to agree with me at the end. So we come from different backgrounds, as you can see here. So obviously, this will be a presentation kind of eclectic, just like this conference has been so far. Yeah, so I am Julianna. Anna will be presenting the next portion of this section, then Solange and Milena. Okay, so I'll get started. Well, as you all know, Brazil is a large country, and I think that's one of the reasons why it's so important to look at it in terms of sustainability. We're now the fifth largest country in the world, just as large as the U.S. Without Alaska and Hawaii. Our distances north and south and east-west are pretty much the same. It's similar to, let's say, going to Seattle, Washington, to Miami, Florida. So it's a pretty long distance. With such a large country, it's normal that we find different regions of the country having very different characteristics. So we have here in green the north of the country, which is mostly known by the Amazon forest. The center west is where most of the agricultural production takes place. Northeast, in orange, is where mostly poverty is concentrated in our country. They suffer a lot from droughts and have seen a lot of their residents migrate to the most industrialized regions of the south, east, and the south. The southeast is where most of the population is. It includes the two largest cities of Rio de Janeiro and São Paulo. And the south region is considered the region with the highest standard or living quality in Brazil. The largest cities of Brazil, well, there are 15 cities with over a million residents as of 2010. Most of those cities, as you can see, are located on and along the coast of Brazil. Three of those are included in the huge metropolitan region of São Paulo. Later on, we'll be focusing on the city of Curitiba here in the south region of Brazil. And as we can see, it is not an extreme case as São Paulo and Rio de Janeiro. It's more typical of all other large cities in Brazil. in terms of population, most of you know that already, our population is growing rapidly. We have reached 191 million in 2010 and projected to reach 219 million as of 2040, when population should start to decline if our annual population growth continues to follow this downwards trend that we see here. We are a very urban country. Since the late 60s, most of the population live in urban cities. We now reached over 80% of people living in urban areas. Most of those, about 40%, are actually living in cities with over 1 million people. According to the Human Development Index, we're now part, and that's since 2005, part of the group of countries with high human development. In fact, GDP is growing, particularly in the past decade, and that is a trend that we also see in terms of GDP per capita. A very similar trend and a huge growth here in the past 10 years. We've also seen improvements in education. This is just one example. Here we see enrollment at the college level. We have seen a big increase here. We have seen also improvements in terms of health. This is again just one statistic in terms of life expectancy going up, and mortality rates going down. So those are pretty good news. They might be a result in part of improvements in water access and sanitation, both here in the rural area in blue, as well as almost 100% access in the urban areas in red. However, sanitation still, we see a huge gap between rural and urban areas, and not a lot of improvement since the 90s. According to the Gini Index, as a measure of inequality, inequality has decreased in Brazil. However, it's still a very high number at about 0.5. The same trend we can find in terms of poverty. Even though poverty level has decreased, we still have about 20% of our population below poverty line. Improvements in terms of access to technology. Here I'm just showing in terms of number of people who use cell phones has increased, as well as internet users, even though this is a very small percentage of the population, obviously. We have had a huge increase, but still a huge digital gap. All this economic development, population growth, improvements in access to technology has also resulted in increased energy use. So here we see that in terms of total energy use in Brazil. And here we see the same trend as energy use per capita. Likewise, we have seen an increase in the emission of carbon dioxide, both in terms of total emissions, as shown here, since the 60s, and emissions per capita. And one last bad news, in terms of deforestation, we have seen a decrease in the percentage of forest area as a percentage of total area in the country, even though for the past few years this change of about 3% is lower than the rates for Canada and the United States, it's obviously still very bad news. Well, I'll pass on to Anna, who will talk about one case study.
Okay, so now that Juliana has given us a very broad picture of Brazil, let's talk about one specific case, the city of Curitiba. Curitiba is the center of a metropolitan region with about 3.5 million residents. It has been known in Brazil and abroad as a model city, a sustainable city, an ecological capital, and a first world city in a third world country. So these labels refers mainly to a series of urban planning efforts that initiated at the 60s and with the approval of a master plan that had it was based on a combination of public transportation and land use strategies to induce the development and growth in a linear way along these four axes as you see in red. So the spontaneous growth that had occurred in a radial form from the center, it was now supposed to follow the transportation corridors. Density should be concentrated along the corridors and decrease with distance from it. So today, the premise of this plan can be visualized in the physical development of the city. The corridors are formed by mixed use and high rise along the transportation route. That includes these large buses and specially designed bus stations. And this system is known as the bus rapid transit system. Other city elements that gave Curitiba this title of model city includes the pedestrian street, many parks, and many plazas. However, despite some very creative urban planning solutions, Curitiba is still a polarized city as many other Brazilian cities. So the center concentrates the greater infrastructure, and as we see is in this first map, the highest land values. Therefore, is the place of residence for the upper classes, while the lower income families are pushed out to the periphery, as we see in the second map. Here in red, we can see the many irregular settlements or slums that along the borders of the city. These areas where the infrastructure is most deficient are the areas that are experiencing the highest growth rates, as we can see in the last map. So in fact, at the metropolitan scale, municipalities around Curitiba, as you see here in purple, they have grown at higher rates than Curitiba itself. Now we return to you.
I will focus on one of those peripheral municipalities here, Pinhais, just to show you what's happening in this area. This is an image of what this periphery looks like, or a portion of it, and there are many elements in this landscape that we would expect to see in a typical peripheral area. So we have undeveloped land, preservation areas and agricultural areas. We also have slums or irregular settlements which take advantage of undeveloped land to squat and create very dense developments with which lack infrastructure. We also see a lot of industrial use, which obviously take advantage of the low cost of land in this area. But there is one thing in this picture which is very recent in the landscape of peripheral cities in Brazil, and that is this guy in the center here. This is an upscale residential enclave, which looks very much like an American suburb. Now, there are many problems with this type of development, and I just wanted to discuss a very few of them. Starting with the fact that in order for that development to happen, zoning had to be changed from an area of environmental protection, which is the green one here. You can see that in that particular place, we had to create a new zoning for that occupation to happen, and that was the unit of territorial occupation. What that means is that now certain types of development, urban development, are allowed. The justification for this change is that if we leave those areas undeveloped as protected areas, we are taking the risk of having more squatters just coming in and settling those undeveloped lands. So if we do some type of organized legal development, such as the upscale development we just saw, then we are protecting those land from squatters. So assuming that environmental impacts of the large upscale development are lower than the squatters. I have a problem with this argument for many reasons, one of which is that the squatters, as we saw before, right here, have no choice. I mean, they have been pushed out of the city by the real estate market. They can't afford to be there. Now, this development is planned, is designed, and people have chosen to move here to what I am calling a suburb. Another issue with that is that it reflects and reinforces the social inequality of our society. So you have in one side of the world people living with these conditions here and facing their new neighbors whose house look like this. Professor Scott Bolins had a concept in one of his slides of relative deprivation, and I think that is applicable here. Now another issue with this type of development is the lifestyle it provides to its residents. It's a lifestyle of isolation, right? Where homes are larger and are protected by gates, and the residents may enjoy shop, play, and pray within their gates. It also creates or increases car dependency just because of the location of those developments, very much like we see in American suburbs. The residents are still dependent dependent of the city, but there is no other way to move from and to the city without a car. It also puts some pressure on land development because we need a larger amount of land to provide housing for a smaller number of people since it's a very low density type of development. Houses are larger, so we assume that energy use is higher. And a challenge to social contact. So this type of isolation, because of its very design and location, decreases the possibility of spontaneous social contact between different classes. Now I zoom out from that one case that I showed and show you this map of the national scope of this problem. This is just, every dot here represents a development just like the one I showed. From the same developer. So this is just one developer there, and it's the largest one, but there are many others just following the same model. And now they have developments all over the country, five different regions. In 2007, they had 37 when this map was created. Now, I just counted last night, they have 49 developments and two in Portugal. And then at the global scale, I have already seen the same type of developments springing in different countries. This is by no means an inclusive list. It's just things that I know of, but I'm sure you might have other examples. I've seen and read examples in South Africa, Indonesia, China, Venezuela, Argentina, Chile. So by no means this is a problem only in Brazil. Okay, this is the hardest slide for me to design. So there is no answer, but I give you a bunch of questions to think about. And those are the things I am concerned with being an urban planner. But so how will all that, those indicators that I showed you earlier, the country is growing, population is growing, GDP is growing, access to technology is growing, how will all that impact the landscape of our cities and metropolitan regions? And what kind of impacts will those changes have for sustainable and social, for social-environmental sustainability? And how should we address those challenges? Should it be at a local level, national level, through policies? How can we minimize the impacts of those developments? So I'll leave you with a bunch of questions and no answers, and I'll pass it to Solange. Thank you.
Thank you, Juliana, for this overview of Brazil. And so I will try to give to you a little, very, very little overview talking about public policies and sustainability in Brazil. Because we have a very big country, a very different, like Juliana showed to us, very different situations. And so it's very difficult to look at them. We can have different views because also we have different backgrounds. We have different interests, but the world is only one. I mean, even when we think about borders, even when we think about regions, even when we think about law, we need not only to think about the national level, the regional level, but we need to bring this experience from the bottom to the up, thinking about also the global level. And so, of course, that many people will say, oh, international law, what is this? It doesn't matter. No, it matters, because we will have to bring these solutions together also to the international level. But, of course, the local, it's our neighborhood, it's people that are living with us. And so we need to take into account all these strategies in all these levels. And so to talk about these public policies and sustainability in Brazil, I would like to make a little introduction, because Juliana and Ana had made all the job of the tough for me. And also our professors, and all these days we have been talking about sustainability and public policies, and I will focus on two main public policies, territorial one and energy, and make some final considerations. Let's go to Brazil. Juliana says to us that we have these five great regions, and when you think about law, we don't have regional laws, but we have the national laws, environmental ones, and our main public policies. We have state level, and we have also municipal level. It's great. Good news. We have a federal constitution that brings to us collective rights, the right to an ecological and balanced environment, the right of indigenous people and quilombolas. I mean, people that came from Africa and that we call the ancestors of African migration slaves in Brazil. And also cultural rights. Are these rights working? Are these rights, they take into account these rights, I mean, social and environmental issues when they are building public policies? Are there real public participation in this process? Why am I asking these questions? I do not think that we can talk about sustainability, sustainable development or sustainable development law if we are only talking about pillars. Pillars that are in one side, in other side, and they are not put together in the same table when we are talking and trying to make considerations in these public policies. I mean, we need to put things together, not only think about economical viability. Oh, it works, it's business. Everything is business. No, everything concerns human lives. Everything concerns culture. Everything concerns how we are living. And so I think also that many concepts can be given about what is sustainability or what is sustainable development. As an analytical tool, we can expose the limits of the traditional conception of development. But what I'm thinking and what is in our hands is that we can use this concept and thinking about a political project that challenges the existing order itself. How to do it? Information, communication, participation, and so let's go on. Let's try. Why not? We had shake our hands in a few minutes ago. Let's make peace, as our friends from Israel said to me when I when we have just started talking about GMOs. Okay, I said to you why law is important. Law is important, but in somehow we need to say how we will consider our behaviors. But of course that it's only a way of see of looking to all these issues. I mean, the public policy, we can look at the public policy as constitution, legislative acts, and judicial decisions. And this is my point of view. But I think that it's not the only one. And when you talk about law, we can talk about positive law. I mean, this law, these rules. And thinking about Brazil, for example, we can say, oh, no, we can forbid this behavior. No one will walk into the grass. We will say, great, we will preserve the grass, we will preserve all the forests. But, and the soccer in Brazil, and the World Cup, how can we do that? We will say, technological solution. Let's think about plastic grass, why not? And so maybe we will think that technology will solve all the problem. But of course, that will be people that will say, no, this is so much. And so let's try to think about how we will deal with this behavior and technological solutions and how the law it will improve or we will enforce law and all these statements, all these commitments. To think about these issues about strategic policies, public policies, and sustainability, we can think about conflicts or we can think about alternatives. Of course, I will point some bad news, I will point some conflicts, but I think that we will need to go on thinking also about these alternatives. Social and environmental issues and social or environmental policies stay in one hand in a little place when you think about everything that we are making in Brazil. And we need to bring bridges or more, we had started to, but we need to have more bridges into these policies and territorial policy, technological policy, and energetic policy also. Juliana has said and has told us about master plans. In Brazil, there is a right to a sustainable city, and the master plans make take into account in the process to build this master plan, must take into account democracy, must take into account participatory process in it. But when you look at Brazil and Julianna point, oh, this is the Amazonia region. Everybody's talking about Amazon forest and everybody is looking to Amazonia region as this forest that is only in Brazil. What I would like to say is that when we look to the Amazon region, it's not only Brazil, and it's the first point. Maybe there is some alternatives. Are an alternative, for example, what Peru has just done, a moratorium for GMO, for protect the biodiversity of this region, a moratorium for 10 years, just last June. Sorry, sometimes my French accent came, but let's go on. Only to have an example of what it represents. We can see that we have, I'm more a left girl than a right one, what it represents in terms of Amazon region, continental one. Brazil has 67% of the region. And of course, the other countries, as Bolivia, Colombia, Ecuador, Guyana, Peru, Suriname, and Venezuela also count. I do not put here French Guiana, because there is only one reason. French Guiana is not part of the ACT, Amazonian Cooperation Treaty, but it's also in this region. And when you think about Brazilian states, we have 9 states in this region that represents almost 61% of Brazilian territory. It's too much. And what is going on? Or what's our challenge in this moment? We have a forest code of 1965 and they want to change it. But we can ask, do we need a new law? Do we need a new code? Why are them, when I say them, is all the rural sector, agribusiness, and also biofuel sector that wants to change the forest code. The forest code established 2 kinds of protected areas, as we say, areas of permanent preservation, APPs, and legal reserves. In this area, you cannot cut, we cannot destroy the forest. The APP are all along the rivers, are in the top of the mountain, and the most important is the legal reserve that for the property, for the owner, and the areas that are rural areas that do not include APP are necessary for the sustainable use of natural resources and biodiversity. In 80% of the rural property in forest area on the Amazon region, on the legal Amazon, we cannot destroy the forest. We can only have timber sustainable management. And 35% of the other rural property and 20% of the rural property in the other regions. There is a bill on our Congress now, and they proposed that we will no more have these commitments. I mean, we will be able to plan to destroy the vegetation in the top of the hill. They will diminish the space all along the river that we cannot build, that we cannot cultivate crops, and also for the properties that are of 400 hectares, there will no more have the obligation to have this legal reserve. You mean that if I am a property, my property has 800 hectares, I will say, oh, Julianna, let's share it, and so no more legal reserve on it. And the most interesting is that people that have deforested these areas till July 2008, there is an amnesty, no more environmental crime. Okay, it's great. It's great, all these amnesties. What does it mean? If the proposed new forest code comes, because the first step in the Chambre des députés, in the Law, we have two, our parliament, our congress, we have the Chamber of Deputies, and I don't know if this is correct translation, and we have the Senate. And so the first step, they approved this new code. And so we are now into the discussion in the Senate. And if it comes, there are estimated that approximately 85 million hectares of the Amazon could be destroyed. It means that this area is an equivalent to the size of England and France together. At least 30 billion tons of CO2 could be released into the atmosphere, 7 times more than the greenhouse gas emissions Brazil committed to cut in Copenhagen, and 15 times more than the China emits in a year. And all the achievements that have been made by President Lula to protect the Amazon and to reduce Brazil's greenhouse gas emissions will be lost unless he prevents this change to the forest code and defends his legacy. What Brazilian people had done till now? We had tried. I had edited a book with the colleagues of mine. We had made we had said no for the new forest code. And now there is a big campaign, a cyber action going on. And so maybe let's try it. Maybe our president will hear our voice and say no to a lot of things that can destroy our forest in these new commitments, in this new forest code. Of course, there are some things that we could change in this statement, in this forest code, but not like that. Even the Brazilian Society of Science has made a study saying, give to us more time. We need more time to study. We need more time to change. And I had made a study in our tribunals, in our high tribunals in Brazil, and I saw that there are many decisions from 2005 till now. The forest code is of 1965, but only after 2005, we had more and more decisions, and the Brazilian judges saying to the property, you need to restore these protected areas that are stated in the forest code. Another issue, we have land and we have energy, and as Julianna shows, we have a lot of cellular cell phones now, we have computers now, we have tablets now, and for this we need energy. Our energy, our matrix is hydroelectric plants, and all these are already built. They are concentrated in the south and southeast region in Brazil. And now we need to put them in the Amazon region, of course. These ones in blue, they are already, they had already had a bind procedure. And these others in rouge, red, are the next ones that will be in this process. This is Giral e Santo Antônio, Complexo Madeira, and this one has just started. It's Belo Monte Dam, and it's about this one that I would like to talk a little. This dam is just here in the Amazon region, where we have a lot of indigenous territories, all of these, all along the Xingu River. And we can think, oh, this case has happened just now. No, it started 35 years ago. In 1975, an hydroelectric inventory studies of the Xingu River Basin has been done. And in 1980, they complete this report, this inventory of a dam of 19,000 megawatts that represents at this time half of the Brazilian hydroelectric capacity. And the flooding more than 1,800 kilometers squares and reached 7,000 Indians, 12 Indians land beyond isolated groups in the regions, as we talked yesterday of isolated groups. In 1988, this report has been approved, and 1989, it was held the first meeting of indigenous people of the Xingu River. This is a photo there, it's in the, it was in the newspapers with a knife, an indigenous one with a knife in the neck of the representative of the company that liked to build the dam. And because of all this mobilization, Brazilian government said, okay, we will stop it, we will not build this dam. But we had a second phase that started in 1994 with new projects in the Amazonas region, and the planned reservoir, for example, was reduced from 1,225 kilometers square to 400 kilometers square, avoiding flood of indigenous area Paquisamba. How is it going when we take into account the side of flow or what Brazilian did at this time? In 10 years, the public prosecutors had started 11 actions in justice, a kind of class actions. And in these actions, they asked, or the main issues of these actions are problems pointed on environmental impact assessment. It's a river, Xingu River, and if you come to Amazonia, and we have two seasons, when there is the rain and when there is no so much rain. And so the river can have a difference of 30 meters. And so we can have beaches and we cannot have beaches. There are seasons that we have so much fish and seasons that there is no fish. And it's this is Amazonia region. And they do not take into account so much these things in this environmental impact assessment. Indigenous rights, indigenous hearings procedures, and environmental license procedures, public hearings, binding procedures, all these problems have been pointed in these actions in justice. We need to say that we have a very active public prosecutors in Brazil, the federal ones, and even one of them has been compelling not to say no more words about this dam, because there is a reaction of the state saying you do not need to say something about this. It's not your affair. It's not your business. This is not your business, even if they have to protect the collective rights. And what people have been doing till now in all these years? Of course, there are many, many manifestations saying Xingu Vivo, it's the river alive, no for this dam. And in front, this is in Rio de Janeiro, here in São Paulo, in Brasília, and all over the world, even all over the world. In terms of law and using different strategies, not only a national one, but a regional one, organizations of human rights submitted a formal petition to the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights on November 2020, denouncing grave and imminent violations upon the rights of indigenous and riverine communities that will be affected by the construction of Belo Monte Dam. On April, the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights granted precautionary measures for the members of the indigenous communities of Xingu River Basin in Pará, Brazil. The International American Commission requested that the state of Brazil must immediately suspend the licensing process for the Belo Monte Hydroelectric Plant project and stop any construction from moving forward until certain minimum conditions were met. If you take into account exactly what the Inter-American Commission of Human Rights says, they said that the state must make a consultation process in order to fulfill all the international obligations, must guarantee access beforehand to the project's social and environmental impact study in an accessible format, including translation into respective indigenous languages, and also adopt measures to protect the life and physical integrity of the members of indigenous people, and to prevent the spread of disease. Let's talk about environmental justice and all the things that we had heard this morning here. And epidemic among the indigenous communities being guaranteed the precautionary measures. What does the government, the Brazilian government, said? Our president ordered an immediate cessation of relations with the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. This is a bad, bad news. And so we can ask ourselves, how can we try alternatives dealing with environmental issues, human rights, and concepts maybe. One of them that we are trying to spread all around the world, they are in some statements, explicit or implicit, it's called the principle of non-regression, the principle of standstill, the principle of status quo. It means that we have achieved a legal environmental protection and we cannot go back. We cannot have a regression of all these rights that we had now in our hands. But when I'm talking about environmental rights, I'm talking about social and environmental rights. Because we can have we cannot have social diversity without biodiversity. But we can have biodiversity without social diversity. It means that the world can go on without human beings, but we cannot live without our planet. This is two photos that I took in Amazonia region. It's a girl, an indigenous girl, in the border of Mana Amazonas, Brazil, Colombia, and Peru. And this is a sunset from our river near the university where I work also, because I work in the southeast part of Brazil and in the north part of Brazil. I'm thinking about my footprint and I don't know how to deal with, but I think that I will not abandon Amazonia region in my heart, but maybe I will not go there so much in the next year. But I think that even if physically we are not in some regions as Brazil, as India, as China, as some little countries, or this little island in the Pacific that will have a lot of problem with climate change, with the rise of the sea. We need to think that we are all together in the same world, and we need to think that there are alternatives. And these alternatives, sometimes they are in the law. They are in the principles, in the concepts that we are can build together. Sometimes they have been built by people on the ground. And a good example that I want to say to you that exists, it's in the Amazonia region, women that are quebradeiras de babassu, they cut a little coconut and they started to empowering themselves, and they had a strategy to be elected at the municipal level to approve laws that guarantee their right to go on in the property, in the private properties, to catch these coconuts, and this legislation forbid private properties to cut down these trees that give to them this possibility of survive. There is a bill nowadays in our National Congress that it's called Law of Babassu Free, and to spread all around the Amazonia region this perspective that the land can be a private property, but we need to think about the social and environmental function of the land. In this sense, we need to think about what we have been producing, and Brazil has been producing bananas. And so, Milena will talk a little to you about bananas and alternative solutions.
Good morning. This morning I would like to show you some unconventional solutions for clean polluted water, for removing heavy metals from the wastewater. The United Nations gives you some assessment about the ideal quantity of clean water every person needs to live comfortably. This is the quantity. If you just have 1,500, things start to be complicated for us, and we are in a critical situation. Let's check the real quantity we have in some countries in my state, São Paulo. According to this report, the values in cubic meters per habitant per year are just these values, and on average, okay? So, after seeing this number, it's not important more to discuss about the importance of water, and more than that, about the importance of keeping this resource clean. Mendeleev, my friend. Besides that, humans have been creating millions of compounds. On a periodic table, you have around 100 chemical elements. However, humans have been creating a lot of synthetic compounds. 39 millions of synthetic compounds have been creating. So the problem here is that just this small quantity is controlled and monitored. So these compounds are affecting our water, our health, and our resources. So what are the typical solutions we have to try to solve this problem? Nanotechnology, membrane filters, or the, for me it's not a kind of solution, but new places for this puzzle. The similarities here is that in my country, all of them are very, very expensive. So to solve new problems, we need to try discover a new solution. So my advice here is to try to look locally. Look for my simple and sustainable solution, or try to think outside of the box. So let's talk about bioabsorption and how does it work. Bioabsorption is a physiochemical process that occurs in certain kind of biomass. You have two types of this process. The first one is called chemical bioabsorption, where the special molecules attract the pollutants because they have different charges, the negative and positive ones. And the second one is physical bioabsorption, where the special structure is a good place to trap the pollutants from the wastewater. Okay. And which type of material can be used for this purpose? Well, researchers around the world are looking for newer materials, but instead of this, I try to use residual biomass. Are those without a commercial value up to date, like banana peels or coconut fibers or moringa seeds, sugarcane fibers, okay? And after I collect the biomass plus the pollutants, I can add some acid solutions, and it's possible to recycle the pollutants too, okay? So, as I promised you, I tell you something about unconventional solutions. I will give you my personal example. As you know, Brazil is very famous for our rich natural resources, or maybe for the soccer players, or the architecture, or the music. But I'm not sure if all of you know that one of the most important resources we have in Brazil are the bananas. I like to draw your attention to some facts. 30% of the annual production of bananas ends up into the trash in Brazil. And the fast food restaurant throw away 4 tons of banana peel. Sorry, a little nervous. I restarted this. And the fast food restaurant throw away 4 tons of this material per week in São Paulo alone. So we are rich in banana peel too. And during my master's program, I dip inside this material. So I develop a powder using banana peel. And I study about the structure which can trap the pollutants, and also about the molecules that are on the surface of banana peel. On the right side, you can see the banana peel and the molecules charged with negative molecules. And here you can see the polluted water. So when I mix this material, I can remove the pollutants for the banana peel. And after 40 minutes, I can remove 65% of the uranium or radiotoxic metal, or 86% of the another kind of heavy metals. The main point here is that the type of fiber used is not important. Luckily, every country or company has a special residual biomass. So it's a great idea to try to look around and try to find a way where nature can help us. And my question here is, why aren't we looking at this type of solution? This is a question to thinking about and discuss during the break time, because I don't know the answer, okay? And now I will tell something about José Claudio Ribeiro, who spent some days in Amazonian forest last year. And he was a Brazilian nut collector who protected his land from illegal loggers. And during his speech in TEDx Amazonia, he predicted that he would be killed by the first try to take his land. Sadly, he was proved right. The fight has turned lethal. In Brazil, it's really sad because if you have $100, you can buy or kill a tree. If you have $25, you can pay someone to kill a man, a hero.
So we'll launch a video and a documentary on a crowd foundation website, and now I will show his lecture on TEDx Amazonia.
Obrigado. Eu vou iniciar a minha palestra contando uma história do local onde eu vivo, do meu município e um pouco da minha história de vida até a data de hoje. Em 97 foi criado no município de Nova Ipixuna o primeiro PAI, Projeto de Assentamento Extrativista, Praia Alta Piranheira. A gente tinha uma cobertura vegetal de 85% de floresta nativa, onde concentrava castanha e cupuaçu. Hoje, com a chegada das madeireiras, das gozeiras que chegaram para Marabá, hoje resta pouco mais de 20% dessa cobertura, já fragmentada em muitos lugares. É um desastre para quem vive do extrativismo como eu, que sou castanheiro desde os 7 anos de idade, vivo da floresta, protejo ela de todo jeito. Por isso, eu vivo com a bala na cabeça a qualquer hora, porque eu vou para cima, eu denuncio os madeireiros, denuncio os carvoeiros, e, por isso, eles acham que eu não posso existir. A mesma coisa que fizeram no Acre com Chico Mendes, querem fazer comigo. A mesma coisa que fizeram com a irmã Dorothy, querem fazer comigo. Eu posso estar hoje aqui conversando com vocês, daqui um mês vocês podem saber a notícia que eu desapareci. Me pergunto, tem medo? Tenho. Sou ser humano, tenho medo. Mas o meu medo não empata de eu ficar calado. Enquanto eu tiver força para andar, eu estarei denunciando todos aqueles que prejudica a floresta. Essas árvores que tem na Amazônia são as minhas irmãs. Eu sou filho da floresta. Eu vivo delas, dependo delas, faço parte delas. Quando eu vejo uma árvore dessa em cima de um caminhão, indo para a serraria, me dá uma dor. É mesmo que eu estou vendo um cortejo fúnebre levando o entre mais querido que você tem. Por quê? É vida. É vida para mim que vivo na floresta. É vida para todos vocês que vivem nos centros urbanos. Porque ela está lá purificando o ar. Ela está lá dando retorno para nós. E o desmando, por causa de um conjunto de gente que só pensa no capital, pensa só neles, não pensa nas futuras gerações, não pensa em nada. Estão fazendo o que estão fazendo no nosso município. É uma vergonha, porque não se acha uma ação corajosa para resolver esse problema. Esse é um entrave. O meu objetivo, como eu vivo da floresta, como eu sobrevivo dela, essa castanheira, como eu sou castanheiro, desde pequeno, vendia in naturo. Como o preço despencou e eu tenho que sobreviver, agora eu estou caçando meio, estou industrializando ela no meu próprio lote. Eu faço óleo, um óleo de primeira qualidade, rico em selênio, bom para fazer todo tipo de comida, frituras e tudo, e se usa como óleo de oliva na salada. O resíduo, que chama bagaço, se faz sorvete, biscoito, que só a imaginação der para fazer e para comer. Isso já está indo para o mercado aos poucos. Pessoal da universidade, pessoal da CPT, CNS, Belém, estão me comprando direto esse óleo, porque, além de ser bom para comer, é ótimo remédio, como vocês sabem, que o selênio combate câncer. agregando valor à floresta. A floresta ela tem que ser preservada de qualquer maneira, porque tudo que existe na floresta é rendável e dá dinheiro. Eu sou artesão em cipó. Se o negócio está preto, eu vou lá, tiro o cipó e faço 10 cestas. Eu faço 100 reais. 10 cestas que eu faço num dia. Cestinha pequena, se é uma cesta maior, se faz 20 reais, uma pela outra, faz 200 reais. E ela está lá, continua me dando. No dia que eu quero, eu vou lá e panho. Agora o cara só acha que ela dá recurso se ser derribada, se ser queimada, se produzir carvão. Isso me deixa triste. Agora eu vou fazer um pedido para vocês, todos que estão aqui. Quando vocês forem comprar alguma coisa que seja derivado de madeira, que seja derivado da floresta, procure a origem. Só assim nós vamos começar a frear uma coisa que a gente não consegue lá no mato. Se você começar a dizer não para as madeiras duvidosas, que não tem procedência, que não tem origem, o mercado vai começar a enfraquecer e eles vão ver que não está dando mais resultado. Ou ele se enquadra dentro da lei ou fecha as portas. Agora, enquanto existir, quem compra madeira ilegal, quem compra coisas ilegais vindo da floresta, isso vai continuar. E quem vai ficar perdendo? Somos nós que vivemos na floresta e vocês que mais tarde não vão ter, porque ela vai acabar um dia. E se acabar, como é que o pessoal, como é que nós vamos viver? Primeiro de tudo, acaba a água. Primeiro de tudo, não vai dar mais alimento, vai faltar essa chuva, como já foi falado aqui pelos outros palestrantes que me antecederam. São coisas para pensar, são coisas para a gente botar a cabeça no travesseiro e ficar pensando, é viável desmatar? Não, ela é viável em pé. É uma coisa que você não agoa, você não bota adubo, você só tem o trabalho de ir buscar o que ela produz. Lá na minha pequena propriedade eu produzo óleo de castanha, manteiga de cupuaçu, polpa de cupuaçu, faço artesanato em cipó e em madeira. Agora, eu aproveito as madeiras que a natureza derriba, que a natureza põe no chão para mim. Eu vou lá, aproveito ela. E no lugar daquela que caiu, eu planto outra. Porque no dia que eu me for, vai ficar minha continuidade aí. Vai ficar outras pessoas que virão e querem a mesma coisa que eu tenho hoje. Então, a floresta é sustentável duas vezes mais em pé do que derribada. Porque quando você derriba, você só tem uma vez. E quando você deixa ela em pé, você tem ela para sempre. Você tem hoje, amanhã, você vai embora, fica outras pessoas que vão se usufruir do mesmo jeito que você e vai viver bem. Será possível que é esse aí o futuro da Amazônia? Será possível que esse aqui é o futuro do planeta? Eu acho que isso nós não queremos, nem hoje, e os que vêm depois. Vão pegar uma coisa dessa, desversificada, morta. É coisa para analisar, é coisa para pensar. Se é isso que nós queremos, não. Está nas nossas mãos e a gente tem um futuro pela frente e deve decidir se nós queremos isso aí ou aquela imagem primeira que foi colocada. Muito obrigado.
Well, I think we have about 10 minutes for questions, and then maybe if there are too many questions, we can ask some questions after the break, but it will be smart if we leave by 12:40 so we can get there on time for lunch break. So I will ask Milena, Solange, and Anna to join me here to answer your questions. In case you have any.
Well, I'll ask you about the banana peels. in the meth house. So what do you do with the pills after they built up the meth house?
Okay. Okay. For example, if I collect some banana peels plus heavy metals, I put this material with some water but plus another acids, and I can remove the pollutants from this material. I can reintroduce them in a company again. So I wash the banana peel 3 times, and I can reuse this material too.
So you can recover the, you can recycle the
water. Yeah, I can recycle banana peel, and it's possible to recycle the heavy metals too. Okay, thank you.
First of all, I'd like to thank you all for those great presentations. Julianna, you mentioned the improvement that has been done in education, health, and so on. And I know from before, could you give us a glimpse of how the Brazilian government has like used those like conditional cash transfer programs and so on, like improving people's health and life and so on?
Sure. Well, in one way, the government has increased expenditure in terms of education. One of the programs it's spending money on, and it's actually a very small budget, but a very effective program, is the cash transfer program, where the government gives some cash to families when they commit to send their children to school. So in this way, the main purpose is that kids don't have to work with their parents on the streets, or especially on farms, to contribute to the family income so they can go to school. So this has increased the number of children in school, but it has obviously some other problems. Sometimes, you know, families may think they should have as many children as possible so they can collect more money. The program has a limit. I think it's 3 children per family. I'm not completely sure. If you know, tell me. But it has been effective in increasing school enrollment and in increasing families' income. So that's one of the measures. Yeah.
The hydroelectric power plant that you're opposing, the alternatives, have you considered the environmental impacts of the alternatives, like burning coal or natural gas, or using some of these nuclear power plants? Because I've seen some studies that suggest that hydropower is environmentally, you know, maybe not as bad as some of these alternative sources. Have you looked at all these alternatives, energy sources for your
country? Yes. I think that the problem with energy matrix in Brazil, there is 2 points to focus on. The first of that is that we spread, I think that we can save almost 20% of our energy on the process. And so we need to improve the process. The second point is that we do not have a real plan for our hydroelectric plants. I mean, we want to build that one. And so we will think about mitigation after. We are not preparing, oh, we will need how much energy for what, for whom. It's not so, we do not have so much transparency. And so I think that one point with energy is know what we are buying, how much energy we are saving or not, if you are a consumer. In the kind of the side of the consumption, but in a political way to say, oh, what are our choices being? Hydroelectric one, nuclear, coal. I mean, we have, for example, biomass that we can have to generate energy. We have to improve solar and wind. I don't know if you had read, but we have just discovered oil in our coastline. And so this is good for Brazil in your hand, but it can be, you know, Holland, Vakolandese, how do you say Cal? That? Holland Cal, there is a theory of Holland Cal in the oil sector. And I think that if Brazil can improve technology to think about energy with this money that came from all this, the exploitation of oil, it can be great. But of course, I do not have an answer. Let's make another hydroelectric power or not. But I think that I can have an answer. Can we have one river without them? Only one, maybe, for future generations? I don't know. But yes, I have two students on the ground because I'm working with payment for ecosystem services. I think that it can be an opportunity, but as I said, of the problem of energy and transparency, I think that it's on point if you think about good governance. And the real point is transparency in Brazil we need. If you talk about energy, if you talk about payment for ecosystem services, if you talk about GMO, all over these issues that make or put science in one sign, society in another sign, and say to you all, the scientists have the solution. Or the scientists are great, but and the social technology and the people and you know, it's very difficult. But answering really your point, there is a law of climate change in Amazon, in the state of Amazon, that we have a kind of bolsa floresta. It means the payment for ecosystem services. And in my point of view, we need more transparency because, for example, to have this money, the guy, he will expend half the money that he will receive with oil to reach the point when he will receive. Because when you talk about Amazonian region, it's not like that, oh, let's walk 30 minutes. Oh, let's take a bus. No, you take a boat. After you walk, after you take another boat, it's the distance are days, you know, to reach your community, it would take me 3 days, 4 days. It's not hours. It's not so. It's more difficult, and I think that the program can work, but we need to empower communities to achieve this goal, and to see where the money is going on. Because as you know, and as other countries, we have corruption also in Brazil. Yes, we have not found a medicine to this till now. A medicine, I mean, to have zero corruption.
The hydropower is a renewable energy, and it reduces carbon footprint. It actually relieves the pressure on cutting the forests and the deforestation for coal as a source of energy. So I kind of got the impression from your presentation that the environmentalists in Brazil are against dams, period. Is that the case, or is it just that they want the dams to be built right with the proper compensation and the proper mitigation of impacts?
Yes, there are two points. Firstly, when you think about Amazonia region and dams, it's not so easy. It's nothing about a river that flows upstairs to downstairs, and you have this flow all the year, the same flow, because of the season of rain and the season that there is no rain. And so this dam, Belo Monte, they think that it will work only 4 months on the year. And so is it sustainable? Is to build $70 billion dam to work only 4 months on the year? This is one point, focusing on the construction of the build. The second one is that there are many studies that are going on that say that it's not so sustainable, hydroelectric plants. Firstly, we have 3 years to compensate all the problems of gas emissions because of the reservoir. We cannot cut all the forests to put the water in the reservoir, you know, upstreams. And so there is emissions that came from the reservoir, and 3 years to balance it. There are expectations that says that almost 3 years to have this balance. But when we created this big reservoir, there are also a problem of the evaporation of all this water that will not go downstreams, and so we can think also about water security and how we will deal with it. The second part of your question was how to compensate these people, how to displace this person. Because in China it was 1.3 billion, and in Brazil, oh, it's only one Indian, only two or three, oh, let's take it then out of there. I think it's not in terms of how many people we are displacing, but what are we losing? All this traditional knowledge, all these possibilities to have the forest. And also, there is a point of no return, no go back. If you deforested more, there are studies that have been made. If you deforested more than 50% of the Amazonian forest, and I mean with the construction of building dams, we will have no more forest on Amazonian region, and no more forest mean no more water, no more possibilities to the dams to work, and so to generate electricity, and so.
I think we need to go, but I know there is one question here we can take after the break. Is there any other question that we should take after the break? Okay, great, so we'll come back to you when we come back from lunch.